about your first project. First project I heard
when I had started our firm right after college. So in fact, the first project I did was to design an extra room on the roof of my parents' house, which was when I was in second year. So we built that out. I still stay there when I visit them. The first project with Vaibhav, I think we did, was the launch of Škoda Octavia. That was an event. So we designed that event for, I think it was ABN AMRO, the bank that was introducing Škoda to India. The first architecture project that we did was, that we completed, was actually the South Asian Human Rights Documentation Center, SAHRDC, of which we've got many, many accolades, and which is probably our most favorite project, continues to be.
So what's the meaning of the...
Anagram?
Yeah.
Do you want the real story or do you want the fake?
I want the real story.
Well, the real story is basically we were hunting for a name that would start with an alphabet A so that we would be on top of any form of directory. And of all the things that we thought, is just when I said anagram, I don't even think Webb understood what I meant. But I think he just liked the sound of it, so we decided to go ahead with it. That's the real story. The fake story, which I must say, because it's important now that we are a firm, is that an anagram basically is a word that has different meanings depending on how you put it together and how you look at it, right? It's the same alphabets. When they're jumbled up and re-looked at, it becomes something completely different. And we feel that, you know, especially in architecture, it offers you a context which, depending on how you look at it, you can come up with a completely different solution. So our basic USP is that none of our projects are exactly the same. So we always try and give a fresh look at what it is that we're doing and start on first principles. So that's the fake story. But you know the real story.
If not an architect, what would you be?
Oh boy. When I was in school, I really wanted to be an economist.
Okay.
And the other alternative was to be a cartoonist. So I've become a cartoon. So, exactly. I used to doodle in my back of my notebook. I used to make all these cartoons. But no one, you know, this is like mid-90s, early 90s. If you said, I want to be a cartoonist, you know what to expect from your father. So that was but I did try and get into NIT. They wouldn't have me.
Oh.
So that if I had got in, I would have probably become a graphic designer of some kind. But I'm happy, very happy I did architecture instead, because it allows me to actually keep in touch with economics a lot more than I expected.
And so, you can doodle as well.
Yeah, exactly. So perhaps it's best that I'm an architect. I get to do both. Think about economics and doodle.
A little tough question. I know it's tough for everyone. So, how should one manage creativity and finance together?
Well, I can't say we've done amazingly well to be able to tell other people how to do it. Look, it helps to have a partner. Like we just discussed, partnerships allow you to straddle many different types of thinking. They're two different brains, two different kinds of ways of going about thinking that you can take advantage of. So, I think the nature of creativity is such that it allows you to think laterally. But a lot of the financial world operates linearly. So, you know, you have to do some work, raise a bill, send it, follow it up, pick it up, know what your expenses are, distribute your earnings accordingly, be wise about the future. So, it's a lot of linear thought. Whereas creativity, the premium is on being out of the box, thinking, doing radical things, taking situations that seem utterly disadvantageous and saying that, okay, I'll turn this around and make it a moment of success for myself. That's what creativity is. So it appears like they don't sit together. But I would say, I'll be very practical. I'll tell you what we did. First thing is, as soon as you can, get yourself into the discipline of financial discipline. That means register, pay your taxes, get a chartered accountant, log in your expenses, pay yourself a salary. Very often, like in the beginning, we weren't we didn't consider our time and our efforts as a cost. So we would pay everyone else their salary, and at the end of the day realize we didn't have enough to pay ourselves. So don't fall into those traps. So right from the get-go, because when you're small, it's easy to establish this discipline. And then eventually, as you grow more and more experience in financial matters, you can make it more elaborate and departmentalize and stuff. But I would say financial discipline is something most creative people don't have. So inculcate that.
Would you like to share? I know you are a constant learner, you are a student all the time and learning from your mistakes too. So would you like to share any kind of lessons you've learned from, you know, your work, your experiences, your mistakes?
Well, yeah, you're right. I mean, anyone running a practice is essentially taking it upon themselves that they're going to continue to learn. So it's always a huge learning curve. I think one of the primary lessons I've learned is I've learned not to take myself too seriously. Because a lot of times we operate from a position of a great deal of passion, and we're very, very convinced by our own ideas and ideologies and so on and so forth. But a practice is like a vessel in a very, you know, stormy sea. It gets thrown around and there are some disappointments that come your way. So one of the lessons I've learned is to have a sense of humor, and especially about yourself and about the predicaments you find yourself in. Thrown around and there are some disappointments that come your way.
What are the mantras that you would like to give to young startups? What are the mistakes they make, you think?
Well, I think being a startup, the second point that I said, be brave, they've already ticked that off. Because to be a startup, you inherently have to be brave. It's not for the weak-kneed. It's not for the weak-hearted. You have to have the ability to take a lot of punishment. Life is very, very unfair to the entrepreneur. So I would say choose partners wisely. It's important for an entrepreneur to have people they trust. So whether it's partners, like I'm lucky enough to have Vaibhav as my partner, who's been amazing. He's been my friend since we met, the first day we met in college. So that sort of deep sort of sense of trust we have for each other is the platform that helps us. It's the foundation that helps us actually, you know, struggle and come up, get out of situations that are very, very tough. We rely on each other for that. So whether you have them as partners within the business or as partners in life or as friends or whatever, it's important to have them. And it's important to choose them wisely while going forward. So yeah, that's my big entrepreneurial lesson.
Know how the architecture education is happening right now. So there are lots of students who would like to learn, but then they do not have the access, or they do not know how to get the best out of the studies that they are doing. What is your message for them?
Well, these are really tough times. It's I think none of the lessons from the past can directly be applied, but perhaps some values from the past can be applied. So the three things that I would say is that you should be honest, whether it is to yourself. Primarily, be honest to yourself. I mean, so if you're enjoying what you do, you need to know yourself well enough to know that, okay, this is something that really I enjoy doing. And these are things that I must do because I need to do them. I may not enjoy them, but this clarity should be there, especially now, because you don't have access to physical conversations with mentors and other people who might be able to kind of guide you through those. The second is to use that honesty to be brave. I think these are times that call for a lot of bravery from students. When I look back at my early college, when I had to join college or when I was in my school, things were much more simple and less critical. Now, decisions have become a lot more critical, especially now post-COVID. Things seem a little out of control. So yeah, so the second point would be to be fearless. Be honest, be fearless. And the third thing, because you're in a design profession, is to be inquisitive. Do not stop asking questions. Now, these three mantras are possibly not very, this is not rocket science, but I do feel that now more than ever before, this is a mantra that I keep repeating to myself. Be honest, be fearless, and be inquisitive.
Why do we have to, when we want to see Indian architecture, why do we have to look at 100 years back or 500 years back to really find some good architecture, Indian architecture. Why not now? Why I'm not able to see some good architecture now? So I thought that why not I'm going to meet you this morning. Why did I put this question to you?
Well, you know how it is. Usually geniuses are recognized well after they have passed away.
Oh, very good answer.
No, I'll tell you what. I have a kind of a philosophical answer for you. I'd say the way architecture is taught and practiced and the kind of buildings that we are seeing right now are already 100 years old. As in, this modernist style that we've applied and is going through certain changes periodically, but is broadly modernist, has existed for 100, 150 years. I have a understanding that the idea of building in any culture goes back thousands of years, actually goes back in time as much as like how we architects like to project into the future. We are not great historians. We are actually storytellers of things that don't exist yet. We are forever telling people your building will look like this. We never tell people your building did look like that, you know. So we, even conservation architects, are conserving for the future. You understand? So there is the philosophical answer is that, you know, there is a sort of a zero state that we all started from, for which we are nostalgic. So some people draw the line 100 years, some people will draw the line 500 years, some people will go back to the beginning of civilization, some people will try and inspect when did human beings started settling down and that is when architecture began. So that is far back in the future. That state is actually, because in our culture, zero and infinity are very often the same thing, is also the state in the future. So the philosophical answer is, it doesn't matter if you're a futuristic architect talking about what we will live like 100 years from now, or you're a nostalgic architect who says, you know, things were so much better when we were simpler and therefore we must roll the time back to a better time that existed in the past. The idea is that we're all motivated to try and create better architecture, better human habitation, better planetary, a better impact on the planet. Now, whether we do that by going back in the past or going into the future is immaterial. To my mind, they're both the same. That's why no one recognizes good architecture when it's happening. It's always, you know, Eiffel Tower was one of the most hated structures for a good 60, 70 years before it became so part of the landscape that then people started identifying with it. So these things are fluid in time.
Share with us any of the five projects that you really want to talk about.
Well, actually, you know what? I think other than one, we've had fights with all our clients on all our favorite projects. So maybe it's a good thing to fight with your client. If yes, the project is good, it's worth fighting for. So I'll tell you the current favorites. I mean, there's one that's, like I said, all-time favorite was our first building.
What we ever really started together with.
Yeah, because it's, you know, it's like your first, it's like your first baby, your first love. Yeah, it's your first thing. And luckily, it got so much appreciation that it's what essentially built the reputation of our firm. So for that reason, South Asian Human Rights Documentation Center would be one of my favorite five. You know, it was and this is of course not just the event of it being our first project. Because it was our first project, that was the time when, you know, we realized that actually what we'd learned in college and what we would learn from the masons on site were two different things. It's not like this one was left out of that or that knowledge was left out of this. We knew about the existence of both, but they're just different ways of thinking. So that was a important learning. So that's why it's one of my favorite. The other one is much more closer in time, which is 2 years back. We did the pavilion for the Kochi Biennale. It was called Kudaram. It's a performance pavilion, which was very radical in the sense that it tried to kind of establish the fact that today in art, performance is not a passive experience that audiences sit quietly and watch a performance. A lot more audience interaction is not just needed, it is possibly better promoted in that way. Because that's what makes up contemporary performance art practice. There's a lot of interaction with the audience. So we tried to change this idea of a black box theater, opened it up, made it very, very accessible. A lot of that architecture of a formal theater creates certain rules that you're not allowed to talk, you're not allowed to eat, you're not, you know, You can't show up late for a performance. So we put question marks in all the in front of all these things. Why can't I come halfway through a performance? Why can't I leave and not disturb other people? You know, so is that possible? So that's where it started. And we wanted to make it a really open public place. It's my favorite because it was really tough. We did it in 2 months after the Kerala floods. So I really must give the credit for creating that architecture to the builders who made it. There's Appu Thomas, who was the main contractor. There was Shanwin, who was the metal fabricator. There's Ali, who was the bamboo crafts person involved. All these guys came together. We worked extremely collaboratively with Manjunath, who was our structural engineer. And so we had all these collaborations going on that project. So it was really fruitful because it all came together in a crunch and we did it in 2 months' time and it was a great success. So it's my favorite.
Wonderful, wonderful. So did you...
Number three would
be... dance around and enjoy the performances?
Yeah, after that. Oh, Kochi, that way, you know, the food, that place is just incredible. So the greatest thing about that project was all our site visits were, it was like taking a holiday. Other than the stress on site, if you go for a walk about, it was kind of like a vacation. So it's one of my favorite places in the country, definitely in the world probably, you know. The third is Project Samman. So this was an extremely challenging project because it was working with the government and with a lot of other stakeholders, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, there were community stakeholders. Samman is a community sanitation project that we started on in 2012-2013. Supposed to be a 4-month quick design project that we were hired for. It ended up being a 3-year design project because of the sheer amount of work. The idea was to build 120 public and community toilets for informal settlements across the cities of Bhubaneswar and Cuttack that would help provide user-friendly toilets. What I mean is public toilets tend to be terrible places and therefore that reduces the enthusiasm with which people use them and they like to prefer to defecate in the open. So could you design the toilet to be more pleasant? So that you can encourage people to use it was the big challenge. And from what I hear now that out of those 120, some 97 odd have been built and have now been operational for a good 6 or 7 years. Now they've been operational for about 3 years, not 6 or 7. They are running successfully. We're getting lots of positive feedback. So it's a very, very satisfying thing because it was really, really tough project for us to do. We are a small firm. We were a young firm. For us to do it was a huge challenge. And I think it's landed on its feet. So that's another favorite.
So which year, which 3 years like you people have worked on this Samman project?
So I think it started in 2013. And then by the time we handed over the tender documents to the government, it was 2016, if I'm not mistaken. Then there are a couple of private residences that stand out. One was recently completed. We call it the cleft house. I mentioned it earlier about the stone being used on the
side. Yes. We have seen that. Yeah.
So it's the kind of project clientele we get very often, which is the typical Delhi family, which is not nuclear, not joint. It's somewhere in the middle. There are multiple generations. Everyone stays together. It's a business family. Usually everyone works in the same organization. There, because of generation gaps, there are lots of lifestyles that are very different that need to live together. So all those things. But equally, there were other things about this client that made it interesting. Self-made man, started off an industry, now doing very well for themselves. So there's a certain, you know, reason why they want to show off their achievements financially. So they wanted a very distinctive house. They came to us saying, we've come to you because we don't want a normal house. We want something radically different. And you know, when architects talk amongst themselves, they always crib about how their clients don't let them do crazy things.
Right.
Or they always talk about how, you know, they wanted to do something better, but were prevented by the client. I think in our experience, perhaps we are lucky that's not happened. We usually find from the most unexpected quarters, people telling us that, you know, why are you being so normal? Why don't you think of something more drastic, you know? And so gentleman and his family were something like that. We didn't expect it, but the most radical of our design options is what they loved. And to their credit, they just stuck it through. they came along this journey where we rediscovered the values of a central courtyard house, a traditional. In fact, that was their response, that it kind of, they live in that house like the way they thought their families would live in their haveli, you know, like a very easy relationship across a courtyard of people screaming and saying ki khana thanda ho raha hai, niche aa jao, phone nahi utha rahe, you know, that sort of informality with which one would kind of associate with a home, but very radical design, very contemporary, and no expenses spared on the parts of the clients in wanting the best, you know, material or the best things in their life. And apparently where they built in a part of Delhi where that house is very, very unusual. So it's a talk of that area, which makes them very, very proud. So
which area?
Oh, it's an industrial area. It's on the way out of, so it's a residential colony that just stands next to an industrial estate on the outskirts of Delhi. So it's got a very noisy highway. You know, it's not South Delhi. But it would be known, our clients felt, you know, why should I be in South Delhi? I want that kind of style and swagger where I am. And sure enough, why not? So that's landed. So that was a, we call it cleft. So that's a very cool house which we enjoyed.
So I can see that it's a connected house where different generations can be together and connected while it does make a statement.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I think it's, I like the fact that it is, it's not a pretentious house. It's a very honest house, but it's very, it's a striking design. You can't mistake it, or
you can't ignore it.
You can't ignore it. Exactly. It's not a docile, it's not a quiet design. It's a very noisy design, but it's very honest. And you know, that's what I like about that house.
That's what people want, right? It should reflect their expression,
absolutely,
their identity.
Yeah, and sometimes, you know, architects, we fall into this trap because we are educated in aesthetics and design and stuff. Sometimes we fall into the trap of judging our clients too much.
Mm-hmm.
And we must try and retain this idea that we're not here to make statements of our own. We're here to try and understand who we are building for. And if there is any knowledge or wisdom that comes out of it, we need to be able to extract that properly and pass it on to other practitioners like students or colleagues or whatever. And that's the nature of architectural practice. It would be incredibly stupid or incredibly arrogant of me to claim that I know how someone else should live their lives. You know, so it's so that's
very good point that you have made, because there is something among the architects that, okay, we want to create something like this and I want to get a client who wants to do something like this. So I think rather than that, you know, getting into the shoes of each and every client, how much you can get and get absorbed into the kind of the identity a client is about, should be reflected into the work.
And you know, Vartika, you'll be surprised that if you spend that time and investment to getting into the head of your client, you will discover people are much more radical than you thought. They are much braver about what they would want their houses or their offices or their anything that they're building to be. They want to push the envelope, but they need to be taken along that journey. You can't lecture them. You can't tell them that their ideas aren't cool enough. It's our job to hunt for coolness in what is in their mind and to be able to take them along that journey with us. I mean, we can't build despite our clients. We have to build with our clients, you know.
100%, I agree with you. The good part. So what's the next one?
The last one, right? I've done four.
Yes.
So this is mine because this was truly a collaborative risk. So typically homes aren't designed with the clients, right? You always talk to them, but you're the person giving them the design, the drawings, the sketches, the 3Ds, and they comment. And they say, ye achha hai, ye bura hai. This is good, not so good, change this, whatever. Give us more options. These are what typically happen. But I designed the home for Anita Dubey, which is a house that we call Artrovert. She was building this in Greater Noida. We had done an art residency in a studio center here called Khoj, which is a contemporary art residency. So Vaibhav and I had been invited, I don't even remember when, maybe 2010 or something like that, to do a workshop, to kind of do art there. And we were very surprised because we don't consider ourselves artists, but it was fun. We liked doing it. But she saw our work and she said, you know, you've got to design my house. And we said, okay. But you know, It was very clear. She had a lot of very stark ideas in her head, but they were, in her mind, art. They hadn't converted into space and form of a building. And the thing is that when she asked, will you design, her idea was not to say that I don't know anything, you come and design. She really made an offer to a collaboration, and we took it in that spirit. And I have to tell you, it was one of the most enjoyable client architect relationships I've had till date, because there's a lot of mutual respect. So initially I found she was, you know, once we were presenting ideas to her, when she saw something she liked or she saw even something she didn't like, it wasn't just a statement from her to say, you know, change this or show me more. She'd actually, you know, enthusiastically take those sheets, spend 2-3 days scribbling over them, doodling, telling, you know, and then she would come and present to us that, look, this is what I feel. You know, and it was so energizing to be in that sort of conversation with someone who is genuinely a very good artist, a very brilliant person. And to be able to kind of have this easy, trustful relationship where, you know, you can just exchange ideas and you can base your architecture on concepts rather than functionality, rather than pragmatics, ki wo nalka ghumega ya wo yahan se, you know, kitne steps mein tum wahan pahunchoge. Those were things that obviously as an architect we have the skill set to resolve. But the really exciting part of Artrovert was working collaboratively at a conceptual level. You know, I still remember very clearly. So I'm quite tall. I'm 6'2". Anita is relatively quite short. And I remember we just finished the basic structure of her house. And until then, you know, I think she had not understood what the way the shape would, the form of the spaces would be. She'd not understood the nature of those spaces. But I remember we walked in and she got so excited. She started running up and down and then yelling at me from there, saying, we should do this here, we should do that there. And it was, for me, it was like, you know, I could see her, because the house is, if you see the design, you'll understand it's a fairly open design. The idea is to be able to look through different spaces at different parts of the house at the same time. So it was really cool to see her, like, you know, I was trying to stand and keep track, you know, where in the building is she, because she would come from somewhere else and then say something else and then disappear and come somewhere else. So it was really fun, you know. So yeah, these are my five. So that one is something that I personally really enjoy.
One is for the young and aspiring architects. You know, in this new normal, what is your message for
them? I will possibly tell them the thing that I think I've learned in the past 20 years is that the nature of practice is full of unpredictability. One, that's the kind of life source for good design, is the uncertainty always produces good design. But it requires a lot of humility to approach uncertainty. You can't be absolutely sure of yourself and say that you know all the best things and no one else can contribute. So my message is, now is possibly as the kind of the best time for designers to step out and try and do radical things, to try and relook at even what I'm telling you, you know, because no lesson from the past can prepare us for what is now going to come directly. I mean, obviously indirectly there are lots of ways, but you need to really apply yourself to the current situation. My only caveat is, do so with a lot of humility, not because you're not amazing or you're not great, but because it is that humility that will end in ideas that will sustain for a longer time. So yeah, so that is the only other thing that I would say, is little humility in approach. Keep learning, yeah, so then you will keep learning.
What is your message for us? So this is Reporter Magazine.
I think the first time you and I spoke was because of the conference you'd held to...
And I remember your height and my height, how it was looking on stage.
I got to on a stage, so already 4 feet taller.
And you know, and you are talking about Anita, I was thinking about I was on the stage.
The guys were normal, I'm the guy who's the tall freak. No, I have to say, I think I must congratulate you, because I think that your organization and the events that you guys hold are picking up on subject matter that are very, very crucial to us. us. I think the gender divide that one sees in architecture is one of the biggest places where change can happen. It's not got to do with buildings and stuff. It's got to do with how we look at ourselves as representatives of society, as representing the demographics of society. It's a very unequal place. I think for me, that's the biggest thing that I can think of when I think of services, is this kind of commitment to looking at the question of gender, because no one likes talking about it. That's number one. And number two, I think that sense of positivity where you're saying that, okay, even if there are difficult times or difficult questions, even this, right, to say that, okay, we want to have conversations about design, we want to keep coming back. You know, it's not like we're going to have this and that's it. Now we'll just do all, but maybe, you know, because that shows an understanding that ideas also change over time.
Yes.
You know, so I think these are, to my mind, the hallmarks of your publication and organization. And I would really look forward to seeing more of you guys doing these sorts of things. Thank you for having me, and congratulations on what you've done so far.